Hello everybody, this is Marian Ulbricht, and in this video you will get a short tutorial to the book chapter Integrating Time-Sensitive Networking. On the agenda we have a short overview about time-sensitive networking and how it is realized in a Comnet emulator. Later on we will have a short hands-on tutorial about IEEE 802.1 QBV, which is the time-aware shaper. At the end, there is another tutorial about 802.1 QCI, which is the pair stream filtering and policing implementation. If we talk about TSN, it's good to know a few standards, which will be presented on this slide. Of course, in time-sensitive networks, there are several devices with several clocks, and it's very important to synchronize these clocks. This is done by the standard IEEE 802.1AS, which implements a clock synchronization on the level of nanoseconds. So this algorithm, which runs on every network device, which can be a router or a switch or an end node, selects the best clock in the network and distributes this clock over the network so that each device have the same time base. The next standard, called QBV, includes the time-aware shaper, which is basically an add-on to network devices output queues. And these queues are ended with gates, and the gates are controlled by the time-sensitive list. With this mechanism, the time-sensitive network devices can control the transmission times of different packet flows. These both features are the minimum requirement for TSN. So if you order a TSN-enabled network device, these two standards are what you get minimum. The QCI standard includes some similar features, where the QBV is placed on the output queue. The QCI includes ingress per stream filtering and policing. And this you see later, but in short, it's basically also a kind of time-aware shaper, which can shape packets. But these packets are policed before they reach the network device's cache. So they are dropped before they are cached, if they are arriving at the wrong time slot, for example. QBU standard is basically an optimization to the time-aware shaper. The time-aware shaper implementation, you have the problem that you have to reserve time gaps for high prior packets, which needs to be protected from low prior packets. And with this add-on in the QBU standard, you will be able to reduce the size of these gaps and use your bandwidth more effective. And the last standard, which I want to name here as important, is the QCC. This is basically the control over every other TSN standard. It includes the stream reservation mechanism, where end devices can configure the whole network to reserve a specific bandwidth or a specific TSN delay for their stream. And it also includes the TSN configuration of each node in the network, using netconf, for example. In the next tutorials, we will use the Comnet emulator, which you should know from other videos. It's basically a VM-based network emulator combining Mininet, traffic control, Docker, and other tools into a standalone network testbed. If you want to have more information or how to set up this emulator, you should take a look at chapter 13 and the corresponding video to get more information. To get the TSN emulation running in the Comnet EMU, we upgraded the kernel to the version 5.2, and this will include an update to the network packet structure, which enables the operating system to determine the transmission timestamp transmission timestamp planning, you are able to implement time aware shaper at the end. So let's have a closer view on the time aware shaper functionality. On this slide, you see the block view of each output port of a time sensitive network device. And what you see is basically a number of queues, and at the end of each queue there's a gate. This gate can be either closed or open. So 0 means it's closed, 1 means it's open. And if the gate is open, the packets which are stored in the queue are transmitted to the output port. Of course, the queues have different priorities. So the highest queue in the standard is queue number 7, have the highest priority, and yeah, they are ordered by priority. What is also important is the gate control list. This list, like the name says, controls the state of the gates of all queues. So the gate control list is basically a list of a time which represents the valid time of each entry and binary mask. So in this case we have a binary mask of 4 bits. So let's have a look at the example of time slot 2. The binary mask represents the state of each gate. So this means the first gate of the queue 0 here is 0. This means the gate is closed. The binary mask have a 1 on the second position. This means the Q1 is open at this point of time. Q2 is also open and the last Q is closed. So with this list you are able to define the state of all gates at each time. This gate control list is processed as a loop. So this means every entry is valid for a defined length of time, for example 500 milliseconds, and the next entry is valid for 200 milliseconds. And if this was the last entry, we begin at the start of the list, and the sum of all entries is named cycle time. So if we have an entry with 500 milliseconds and the entry with 200 milliseconds, we have at the end a cycle time of 700 milliseconds. And in the TAS or the Time Aware Shaper standard, you can define the time slots of the list with a granularity of 1 nanosecond. So this is really precise. This means you can select the transmission time of each packet in your network with a granularity of 1 nanoseconds. So let's start our example with the Comnets EMU. At first, of course, you have to check out the Comnets EMU and you have to set up the VM by running the vagrant start command described in chapter 13. And as an additional step for the TSN simulation, you have to run the install tsn testbed.sh script, which is placed in the comnets emu slash util directory, but this is also described in the chapter. If you have run this script, which depends on 2 steps, you will upgrade your kernel to version 5.2 and you will install a special improved network driver, which is able to simulate the TSN features we want to show in the next slides. So this network driver will create 4 virtual interfaces. The name of the virtual interfaces are TN1, TN0, TN2 and TN3. And 2 of these interfaces are connected through a virtual tunnel. This means each packet you put into the interface TN0 will come out in interface TN1, and each interface each packet you will put into the TN2 interface will come out at the TN3 interface. And also the other direction is also working. So on each of these interfaces you can apply special rules to enable the time-sensitive network features. So let's start with hands-on. I have opened three windows through SSH to the Comnetz emulator, and I am in the folder tasim, which is created by the install script. Let's have a short look into the folder. We have some installation scripts and some test packets. And I would suggest to have a short look at the installation script here, because we change our topology of the network tunnels a little bit. So let's open this with Nano. Okay, what you see here is the creation of a bridge named BR0, and this bridge includes the interfaces TN1 and TN2 and loads some kernel modules which we need later. And if we set up this bridge, we have a chain of network interfaces. It's a little bit similar to the figure of the last slide you have seen. So this means we have the tunnel between TN0 and TN1, which is handled by the network driver. Then we created our new bridge BR0, and we have the tunnel between TN2 and TN3. And of course, caused by the bridge, the traffic from TN1 is also forwarded to TN2 by broadcast. So, why we do this? Easy reason, because we want to replay traffic or packets with the tool TCP replay, and we need some IP table firewall rules to be applied to these packets. But unfortunately, these firewall rules are not applied to TCP replay packets. They are applied to every other packet which is coming into your VM or into your network device, but TCP replay packets are not handled by this. And for this reason, we replay packets from TCP replay into the TN0 network interface. Then we go to the first tunnel. And then if the packets coming out here, they are affected by the firewall rules and we can work with them. So this is the reason why we have two of these TSN network tunnels. But basically, we will apply the TSN rules here at the TSN interface TN2 and sniff what is coming out at the TSN interface TN3. So this is the reason why I have four interfaces here. Let's close this. And we should also have a look at our test packets. So I simply open them with Wireshark. Short minute. So our test packets are also really simple. They have the same source IP address. And what you see, every other thing is toggling. So this means the destination IP address is toggling. There's one packet with 4x2, then one packet with 4x1 is coming, and also the source and destination MAC address is also toggling over the packets. So this you should keep in mind, because we will change the order of the packets using the time-aware shaper later. So let's close this and start the replay of these test packets. I will use this window on the left down corner. So I simply start TCP replay on the interface, on the first interface TN0. I will have an infinite loop and 10 packets per second. So that's of course a small packet rate, but it will be enough to see the effect of the time aware shaper. So let's start this. And of course we want to see what we are sending. For this you can use TCP dump on the interface TN. Let's start with the interface TN1. This is the output of the first tunnel. And what we see are the packets. I will stop this. And you see the same like in Wireshark, the IP address here, which is shown here, is toggling. This is what you should keep in mind. I can also start the dumping on the first interface of the second tunnel. There you should see the same, because we don't start the time aware shaper yet. And also on the output of the tunnel, there's also the same. So I will keep this running. Then we see the effect of the time aware shaper immediately. Okay, let's talk about the command to set up the time aware shaper. Of course, the implementation is similar to the implementation of the blocks shown showed on the last slide. But the configuration using TC, also means traffic control rule, is a little bit more complicated. So you have several mappings from priorities to traffic classes and to queues, and this is done by this command. Here you also define the gate control list, and at the end you forward your IP packets using firewall rules of IP table to a specific priority. So let's have a look at the first command to set up the time aware shaper using TC and QDisk. So what we see here, we are working on interface TN2. This means the entry interface of the second TSN tunnel we are using. And what is important is we're using here two traffic classes. This is defined by this num of TC command. Because at the end we have just two different type of packets and we just use two traffic classes. So the QDisk module supports 16 different priorities, and the priorities are mapped to the traffic classes. This is done by this map. So you see 16 digits here, and each digit stands for one priority. And so this map means priority 1 is mapped to traffic class 0, and priority 0 is mapped to traffic class 0, and priority 1 is mapped to traffic class 1, priority 2 is mapped to traffic class 1, and so on, because we have just two traffic classes here. So this is basically what I mean with this comment. You map priority 0 to traffic class 0, and you map priority 1 to traffic class 1. So at the end, we map the traffic classes to output queues. This is done in the next line. So basically, the traffic class 0 to output queue 0, and traffic class 1 to output queue 1. So now we have basically this mapping, which is shown in the comment here. And let's have a look at the gate control list definition. This is done by this schedule entry command. So as you see, we have three entries in our gate control list. This is done by this S command here. So we have three S commands, which define each one entry in the gate control list. So as we have seen in the last slide, in each entry in the gate control list have a bitmap corresponding with gate states. This is basically this. So this means entry 1 of the gate control list have a duration of 0.5 seconds, which is here this value represented in nanoseconds. And the gate state means gate 0 is open is 01 for the first entry. So let's have a look at the second entry. Here the gate state is 2, which is in binary 1-0, which means the first the gate of the first queue is open, and also this entry rests for 0.5 seconds. And then we have a third entry in our list. The all gates are closed, and also this entry have a duration of 0.5 seconds. So let's simply copy the first part of the command and see what happens. So I copy the time aware shaper configuration as one block and paste it to the Comnet's emulator. So please have a look at the traffic in the right down window. Now it's not affected, and if I apply the command, you will see some action. You see the traffic is forwarded for, let's say, half a second, and then there is a pause of 1 second. Yeah. So what we did now, actually every traffic have the same priority, because we didn't configure the priority. So every packet goes with priority 0 through the time aware shaper, and we did configure 3 entries in our gate control list. So every packet with the priority 0 will be in the queue 0, which is here for half a second open, and the other states where here is defined gate 1 is open and no gate is open will block this traffic. So this means for half a second we see our traffic flowing, and for 1 second, this is the sum of these both entries, the traffic is blocked. So now I have more commands which will forward our traffic depending on the IP address. Here IP address 1111 to priority 0, and IP address 2222 to priority 1. And if I apply this, we split our traffic into both queues 0 and 1. So I just copy the commands and paste it here. So, and you see what changed in this window. There is a forwarding of every packet with the IP address as destination 1111. After this, all packets with the IP address 2222 are forwarded, and then no packet is forwarded. So this is in detail what we apply as a gate control list. So just traffic in Q1, just traffic in Q2, and no traffic. So it's also interesting to see this traffic here in Wireshark. For this reason, I will make the traffic a little bit faster. I will change to 100 packets per second and replay them again. And I will write my output to a file. Let's call it tas_test.pcap. So actually we don't see our traffic because it's written to the file. Let's wait some seconds. Okay, stop this. And now I will open this file with my Wireshark. Okay, first what we see is the same as of the DCP dump output. We see a lot of sorted packages. So we have here the sort of destination and test 2, and here is the sort of the destination address 1 is coming. And what we can do in Wireshark, we can view the statistics, for example the IO graph. So let's make this window a little bit bigger, adjust the x-axis. Okay, so this is the interesting stuff. So, you see basically how many packets per second are delivered at which time. So you see two bursts and a gap. So this is why the time aware shaper doesn't discard the packets. All packets which are reach a queue where the gate is closed are stored, and if the gate open, they are passing the output port in a burst. This is what you see here. If a queue and the gate opens, there is a burst of stored packets, and then the flow goes on with a normal packet rate. So this is the normal packet rate here, and then we're closing gate 0 and opening gate 1. There is another burst of the packets with the IP address 222, and then we have the normal packet rate of this stream. And then we see the third phase of our gate control list, where no gate is closed, so no traffic is passing here. So this is basically the limit, what you can do with the TSN features in the emulator. And for this reason, I took one of these hardware research routers we have at the chair and connect to Raspberry Pis. And I will short show you the configuration of this router with the Raspberry Pis connected to port 0 and port 3. So we will do the same example. We are sending TCP replay packets into port 0 and capturing the TCP replay packets at port 3. So I can simply log in into the device using SSH. And you see, I have again three windows. So we have our transmitting Raspberry Pi and our receiving Raspberry Pi. Here I simply start TCP dump and start the transmission of TCP replay with the same test packets we seen in the last tutorial. And as you see, with a packet rate of 100 packets per second, we have again the toggling IP addresses. So, I will apply two rules to the device to match the traffic first. I will match here on the MAC addresses of both different streams and forward stream 1 with MAC address 1 to queue 0 of port 3 and stream 2 with MAC address 3 to queue 1 of port 3. So simply copy this both and paste it. Okay, and just checking in the website of the router, we see the traffic is forwarded from port 0 to port 3. And we see some broadcast packets here, but that's what we want to have. So now let's do something similar. We can apply the gate control list, which is a little bit more straightforward than using the TC commands here. So we simply control the TSN module of the router, and we generate two entries of the gate control list. So entry 0 and entry 1. This is the mask of the gates. So the first entry will have gate of Q0 open, and the last entry or the second entry will have every gate open except Q0, and each of this entry will rest for half a second, and we working on the output port, which is in this case port 3. So then we have a last command to apply the changes to the hardware. We say he should calculate the cycle time by itself, because he knows we have two entries in the list. One is half a second, and this means the sum of each entry, the sum of both entries, are 1 second cycle time. And we also say that the start of the cycle will be at 0. So with this flag, you can apply a phase shift to your gate control list. So this means if you have two devices in your network and we apply this command to both of these devices, the gate control list will start at the same point of time. So these devices will be fully synchronized. And with this parameter called base time, you can apply a phase shift and let the second gate control list, for example, start a little bit later. So simply copy the commands to the trust node and see what happens. So at this example, we have just two entries in the gate control list, and you see what happens with the traffic. We are opening the traffic for traffic type 1 or for traffic type 2, in both cases for half a second. Okay, let's have a look to the second hands-on example, which should show you the standard IEEE 802.1 QCI in action. And as I told you, the QCI implementation, here you see the block view, is a little bit similar to the time-aware shaper implementation. So you split your traffic into streams, and for this stream you can apply priorities, meters for measuring the stream rate, for example, or the packet rate, or the packet sizes, counters. And these streams you will map into gates. The gates have the same behavior like the QPV gates, but here you have an additional value which is called IPV. And this IPV value is added to the packet and can be, for example, used in the metering unit after the gate. So you basically map your packets into the streams, pass them through gates, and forward them to the network device. One difference to the QBV, the time-aware shaper implementation, is that this happens before the network device's buffer is passed. So this happens in the ingress data path if the packets arrived at the network device. So the gates have a different impact to the traffic stream. If a gate is closed, all packets are discarded, and if a gate is open, the packets will pass through the network device and handled by the internal buffer and forwarded using the forwarding engine. Yeah. Also in this implementation, the QCI, we have a list which is called gate control list, and this gate control list is applied for every gate. So you see we have here gate 0, gate 1, gate 2, gate 3, and you simply define if the gate is closed or open. So similar to the QBV implementation, you have a time where the gate have a dedicated state. In this case here it's closed, and you can also change the IPV value, which is a kind of flag, with this gate control list. So you can specify for each time a packet can arrive at a network device if it is handled by a closed gate, so it will be discarded, or if it's handled by an open gate, then it will tagged with a special value which can be used for measurements in the network device. Yeah. This is basically the functionality of the QCI implementation, and now we will see what happens if we use the hardware device for running an example. So let's log into the hardware network testing device again, and I will start a stream again, now with 1000 packets per second. And I will also the capture starting. Okay. So, of course, we have to apply some commands. I choose a really simple example here. So, where I will forward both streams into gate 0. And here I have a simple gate control list which opens gate 0 for a quarter second and closes all gates for a quarter second. And yeah, we will simply show later in Wireshark what happens here. So I will apply the first two commands, which enables the QCI engine. And what we see here is what is expected. The default state of the QCI engine is to block everything. And now we configure the gate control list again using the QCI CTL tool. And what you see now is that for some times the packet, the traffic is blocked, or for some times the traffic is forwarded. So let's have a closer look to this using Wireshark. So I simply capture the traffic into the file test_tsn.pcap. So let's wait some seconds. Okay, that's enough. And now we show the file in Wireshark. Okay, and we again analyze the statistics of our captured traffic and generating the IO graph and adapting the axis. And as what you see here is that for one slot in the gate control list, we are blocking all traffic, so you see the traffic rate is 0 here, and for one slot in the gate control list, we forwarding all traffic. So this is a simple gate control list we applied, and this shows exactly the difference between the QCI implementation and the QBV implementation. The QBV implementation stores the packets inside of queues until they will be released if the gate opens, and the QCI implementation will drop packets if the gate is closed. The idea behind is that the QCI can protect the network device and the network, for example, from babbling idiots, which are sending a huge amount of traffic at the wrong point of time, and this traffic is simply discarded. The standard also defines some traps. For example, if the traffic arrives at the wrong point of time, the gate will never open again, or if the traffic exceeds one limit of traffic rate, the gate will be closed for a long time until it's released manually, or yeah, similar stuff is possible with the QCI standard. By the way, if for what you see here at the top is a little bit an inaccuracy of the traffic generation of the Raspberry Pis, which are not real-time systems. So this is the end of the video. You have seen a short summarize on important time-sensitive networking standards and two hands-on tutorials, one for the time-aware shaper for the QBV implementation and one for the per stream packet filtering implementation of QCI. I hope you enjoyed and are curious for more tutorials. See you. Bye.